Hello everyone, welcome to today's class. Today we're going to see Strategic Management Unit 3. The first heading is Grand Strategy. We should know what it is. So the introduction of Grand Strategy means it is often called master or a business strategy. So it provides basic direction for the strategic action. So which indicate the time period over the which long range objectives are to be achieved. So in this, firms involved with multiple industries, business, product lines and customer groups. So these usually combine several grand strategies. So any one of these means a business, product, multiple, okay. So any one of these strategies could serve as basis for achieving the major long-term objectives of a single firm. So this is the introduction of the grand strategies. And then we're going to see the meaning, okay? So what strategies, grand strategies means? So it means that will be used to achieve the long-term objectives, which used to achieve long-term objectives. For examples, business grand strategies that can be customized for a specific firm. The firm includes market concentration, market development, product development, innovation, horizontal integration, divestiture, liquidation. So these are the examples for to achieve long-term objectives. So this is the grand strategy introduction meaning. Next one is definition. How it is defined? Okay, how grand strategies are defined? So based on this, these are corporate level strategies designed to identify the firm's choice with the respect to the direction. So it flows to accomplish its set objectives. So simply, it involves the decision of choosing the long-term plans from the set of available alternatives. So grand strategies are means to get to your ends. So which means a growth, profitability, etc. So the more time that you spend researching and learning about your environment, your market and a business, the more clearly this comes into your focus. So while there is always some certainty, means unexpected thing, okay, some risk, okay. So with the business decision, a strategic decision with a proper homework done is a pretty clear cut. So these are, the next one is objectives or grand strategy alternatives. So what are the grand strategy alternatives we're going to see? The first one, stability strategy. So which means a stability, which means it is implies continuing the current activities of the firm. So without any significant change in the direction, if the environment is unstable and the firm is doing well, so then it may believe that it is better to make no changes. So a firm is said to be following stability strategy if it is satisfied with the same market share, satisfied with the improvements of functional performance, and the management does not want to take any risk. So this might be associated with expansion of growth. So for example, stability strategy, so it has been stable company, which for example, XSX have been a stable company during the recent years. So despite the competition from Orange company, okay, though X has remained stable, so have been going concern method. So this beverage also being used by stability strategy. So in general, this strategy can be very useful in short run, but can be dangerous it followed too long. This stability strategy is mainly used for a short run, okay. The next one is expansion strategy. So expansion strategy, nothing, it is most widely pursued corporate strategies. So in this, companies that do business in expanding in the industries, so must go to survive. A company can grow internally by expanding its operation. It can grow externally through mergers, acquisitions, joint ventures and strategic alliances. So next one, retrenchment strategies. So retrenchment mainly known as, the company may pursue retrenchment strategies when it has a weak competitive position. So in some of all the product lines resulting in a poor performance. So in this, in an attempt to eliminate the weakness, so which attempt to eliminate the weakness or that are dragging the company down. So the management may follow one or more of the following retrenchment strategies. So which goes under next slides, okay. Then combination strategy. So it means a combination of two or more corporate strategy. So but a combination strategy can be exceptionally risky if carried out too far. The same as stability. The stability and combination, if it's carried out too far or a long term means, it won't work. It will be in a risk only. Okay. So this might be benefit of the firm. So difficult decision must be made and priorities must be established. Organization, like individuals have a limited resources. So organization must choose among the alternative strategies. Under this objectives, the second one, expansion strategy. Okay. Under this expansion strategy, we gonna see the types. Okay. First one, intensive. Second one, integration. Third one, diversification. So first, intensive strategy. We already know what is expansion. It is most widely pursued in corporate companies. So it can grow internally. So it will grow in internal and expanding its operations. That is expansion strategy. So in this, the first point is intensive. Intensive means without moving outside of the organization current range, okay, of a product. And there are three important intensive strategies. And under this intensive, there are three important: market penetration, which means a seeks to increase market share for existing product. It seeks to increase the market share. The second one, market development. So which increase the market share by selling the present product in a new market. Third one, product development. So which seeks to increase market share by developing a new or improved product. Okay, these are known as expansion strategy under intensive strategy. The next one, integration strategy. So which means, it is means combining activities relating to the present activity of a firm. So a company performs a number of activities to transform an output to output input into output. So these activities include right from the procurement of raw materials, the production of a finished goods, and the marketing distribution to the ultimate customers. So the two types of integration is vertical integration, backward integration, forward integration, horizontal integration. So mainly the vertical means it involves gaining ownership and increased control over the supplier and distributors. So this vertical integration is of two types. The backward integration means gaining of ownership of firm supplier. By suppliers, it will gain the ownership. Then forward integration means it will gaining ownership or increased control over the distributor or suppliers, retailers, okay. And the fourth one is horizontal integration. So which means, it is a seeking strategy, ownership or increased control over the firm's competitor. So this is the four types of integration. And then diversification means it is the process of adding new business to existing business, new to existing. So in other words, diversification adds new products or markets in existing. So this strategy is concerned with achieving a greater market from the greater range of products in order to maximize the product. So in this diversification, there are types. The first one is concentrating diversification. So concentrating means adding to new. So but related business is called concentrating. So it involves acquisition of business that are related to the acquiring firms or a technology. Next, conglomerate means which adding to new. Okay. So but unrelated is called a conglomerate. So which added new but it is unrelated. For concentrating, it is related. Conglomerate, it is not related. Okay. The next one is example for diversification. So for example, some telecom industry, telecommunication. Okay. The internal service is a provider and it was found 1992. The merger between a former. So this became a major provider of a voice. Okay. In this, the innovative useful technologies were launched in the multiply services. Okay, so the maturity will become among the first countries. So it may be they are adding a new, but it will be if it is related, it is a concentric, and it is not related means conglomerate. Okay, the next one is example which we finished. The third one, retrenchment strategy. We already seen retrenchment strategy when it has a weak competitive positions. So if it is a weak competition position, all of the product lines resulting in a poor performance. Okay. So under this, first one is the turnaround. So which means a firm is said to be sick when it faces a severe cash crunch or a consistent downtrend in its operating profit. So such a firm becomes insolvent unless appropriate internal external actions are taken to change financial picture of the firm. And next one is bankruptcy. So which is a form of defensive. So it allows organization to file a petition in the court or a legal protection to the firm in case of it is not a position to pay its debt. And third one is liquidation. Okay, the liquidation is nothing. It is an entire company dissolves and its assets are sold. So it is a strategy of last resort. So where there are no buyers of a business and the company may be wound up and its assets may be sold to satisfy debt obligations. Then third one, divestiture. Divestiture means selling a division or a part of an organization. Okay, selling a division or part of the organizations. And then fourth one is combination strategy, which we already seen. And this next, differentiate domestic strategy and global strategy. How it is differentiated? So mainly the companies on either extreme or at a multi-domestic or a global. So these corporation multiple foreign operations that act independently of one another follow domestic strategies. Each individual operation is treated as an independent business. So with the country of each operation essentially becoming its domestic market. So on-site managers of such an operations are more or less independent entities focused solely on their local market and free to develop individually tailoring strategies. Under this, mainly at the other extreme, corporations that standardize or tightly integrated operations in different countries follow global strategies. So these corporations operate all units regardless to location under the single unifying strategy. So in this purest forms, domestic and global strategies differ greatly from each other along with two dimensions. And the next which we gonna see is continuum from global to domestic strategy. So which means it is even the business units on the same industry usually offer very different products or services. So in contrast, business units in a corporation following purely global strategy sell very similar products or service. So this rationale for this difference can be understood best when you consider a second important differences. So mainly in this case, this domestic strategy, each country's business unit will comprise as much of the value chain is feasible. Okay, so under this, on the other hand, a firm's following a pure global strategy serves its various markets from centralized facilities, so limiting replications of the value chain in various countries. The next which we're gonna see is the social imperative. Okay, the social imperative means it has a social forces which encourage MNC, okay, to adapting individual parts of their flung operations to specific situation. The first cultural difference across countries often necessitates changes in a tactics. So third, as the industrial spreads, local competitors scramble severe narrowing market segments. This forcing MNC to be equally adaptable. So when local suppliers can design for another market consumers. Thus, most business adjust the way they do business from one country to the next. So these firms must often adapt their products, marketing techniques to suit host countries' particular circumstances. The next one is which we gonna various strategies. So which is various strategies illustrated. So Avon's, okay, Avon is a brand, okay, door-to-door marketing methods have successfully sold its cosmetics nearly everywhere in the world. So however, during this first year in Japan, okay, the company had a little success using this approach. So after studying the problem only, the managers at Avon discovered the Japanese women are often too reserved to make a forceful sales pitches to strangers. So this company then adjusted its approach to selling in Japan and making sales to women who were not strangers and creating advertising campaign features. So, soft sell approach to a poetic image. Though after this adjustment only, the firm enlisted more than 350,000 saleswomen in Japan. So, its Japanese sales grew more than a 25% of the year. Then the economic imperative. So which means in some industries the volume necessary to achieve greatest economic of a sale and learning curve effects cannot be reached within a single country. So in this case it makes a sense to combine operations in different countries and to increase the throughout gain economic sales. A corporation with a global integration can use its network. Okay, so for example Caterpillar. So we also have a Caterpillar in our place. Okay, so this company would leading the producer of a heavy earth moving equipment, so utilizes this sort of integration. It's a worldwide operations. So in this it has its factories within a given country focused on a volume production of the relatively narrow range of products, so resulting in maximum economics of a sales and learning curve effects within each factory. So in this, the use of such strategies and the globalization of industries are to raise because of the several trends, the emergence of a products with the worldwide acceptances. So such as the German and the cameras as facilitates worldwide integration, means an icon, okay. And the next one is combining global and domestic outlooks. How will they combine? So as each strategy has its advantage. So the best approach is usually neither purely domestic nor purely global. So but combination of both. So this becomes most apparent when we see shortcomings of single-mindedly pursuing an international strategy based on their global integration alone, domestic adaption alone. So next one is convergence of global and domestic strategies. How will they convergence? So reacting to the forces and counter forces driving them to adapt element of both global and domestic. So many of the most successful MNC have coverage of these two stands. So industries that were once cited as example of a pure domestic operations are becoming globalized vice versa. So the consumer elastic industry and laundry detergent industries provide classic examples. The next one which we gonna see is generic strategies, which means apportes generic strategies. Okay, the definitions. So mainly a generic strategy means it is a Michael Porter, okay, who developed these three strategies that company could use to gain a competitive advantage back in 1980. So these three are cost leadership, differentiation and focus. Okay, so mainly this can be applied to products and services in all industries to all the organization and size. So they will first set out the Michael Porter 1985. So in this book, the book which is called Creating Sustaining Superior Performance, which is in Competitive Advantage book. Okay, so in this Porter called the generic advantage, the generic strategies, cost leadership, differentiation and the focus. He then subdivided the focus into two parts, cost focus and differentiate focus. The term cost focus and differentiate focus can be a little confusing as they could be interpreted as meaning focus on cost, so focus on differentiation. So remember, the cost focus means emphasizing cost minimization within a focused market. Okay, differentiation means they will pursue strategic differentiation within a focused market. So the cost leadership strategy, so mainly known as these thing. So this is the Porter's generic strategy. So which has cost leadership, cost focus, differentiation leadership, differentiation focus. So this is the sources of competitive advantage in this market where business competes. Okay, it is a differentiation and cost broad narrow. So mainly the cost leadership strategy we already seen. So in this, so mainly the differentiation strategy. So which makes a differentiation strategy organization? So good research development and innovation, the ability to deliver high quality products and services, effective sales and marketing, so that the market understand the benefits are offered by the differentiated offerings. So in this, the first we're going to see the focus strategy. So which means it will focus strategy concentrate, okay, on a particular markets. So by understanding dynamics of the products. So as with the broad market strategy, it is still essential to decide whether your pursue cost leadership or differentiation. Okay, once you have selected the focus strategy as your main approach, focus is not normally enough on its own. So, but whether you use cost focus and a differentiation focus, the key is to making a success of generic focus strategy means you are adding something extra as a result of serving only the market niche. Okay, so it is simply not enough to focus on only one market segments because your organization is too small to serve a broader market. If you do, you are risk competing against a better resourced broad market companies. So, the something extra that you add can contribute to reducing cost. So, which is to increasing differentiations. The tip means it has to apply, means generic strategies apply to not-for-profit organization. So, in this, a not-for-profit can be used a cost leadership strategy to minimize the cost of getting donations, achieving more from its income. So, while I'm pursuing a differentiation strategy, will be committed to a very best outcomes, even if the volume of the work it does as a result is smaller. And next one is choosing the right strategy. Okay, you chose which strategy to pursue underpins every other strategic decision. So, but you do need to make a decision because Porter specifically warns against trying to hedge your bets. So, by the following more than one strategy, one of the most important reasons why this is wise advice is that the things you need to do to make each type of the strategy work appeal to different types of people. So, the cost leadership requires very detailed internal focus on processes. So, the differentiation on the other hand demands an outward facing highly creative approach. So, when you come to choose which the three generic strategies is for you, it's vital that you take your organization competencies and strengths into account. So, use the following steps, the steps which we're going to see. The first one, SWOT analysis. We already see this SWOT in more subjects upcoming, okay? SWOT analysis means strength, weakness, opportunities and threats. Okay, this is the thing. So, in this, it would face if you adopted that strategy, this strategy SWOT. Having done this, it may clear that your organization is unlikely to be able to make a success of some of the generic strategies. So, mainly this SWOT, strength and weakness are helpful for the organization. Opportunities and threats are harmful for the organization. So, this is the main thing, okay? So, then the next step is 5 forces analysis. So, based on this, to understand the nature of the industry you are. So, we have to check the 5 forces. Which are the forces analysis are mainly in this forces, okay? And then third step is set of options, okay? One sec. Actually, the 5 forces analysis is mainly from the Porter's analysis, okay? So, this Porter's analysis mainly come 5 forces analysis. So, which means based on this, because this analysis is an important tool for understanding the forces that shape a competition within an industry. So, it is useful for helping you to adjust your strategy to suit your competitive environment and to improve your potential profits. So, mainly these 5 forces, okay, forces which are 5 means. So, mainly this is competitive, okay, the supplier power, buyer power, threat of new entry, threat of substitute. So, this is the 5 forces of analysis. So, next one, step 3 is set of options. So, why it is set of options means to compare SWOT analysis and variable strategic options with the result of your 5 forces analysis. So, for each strategic option, ask yourself how could you use that as strategy. So, whether to reduce or manage supplier power, to reduce or manage buyer or customer power, come out on a top of the competitive rivalry. So reduce or eliminate the threat of the substitution. Okay, so reduce and eliminate threat of the new entry. These are the five forces. Okay, so in this, select the generic strategy that gives you a stronger set of options. So mainly the Porter's generic strategies offer a great, gives you the strongest set of options. Okay, this is according to the Porter's. There are three basic strategic options. So what is cost leadership, differentiation and focus. And the next one is aggressive strategy. So which means it can be categorized in many. Okay, one popular method is to assess strategies based on their degree of aggressiveness. Okay, this aggressive strategy are related according to their marketing assertiveness. So their risk propensity, financing leverage, production innovation, speed and decision making amongst others. So typically the range of aggressive strategy is called as into four categories. The first one, prospector, second, defender, third, analyzer and reactor. The next one is prospector. So basically these aggressive strategies classify into four. Okay, the under this the first one is prospector. So this is the most aggressive four strategies. So it typically involves active programs to expand into new markets and stimulate new opportunities. So this new development is vigorously pursued in offensive marketing strategies are common way to obtaining additional market share. So the large proportion of their revenue comes from new product or new markets. They are often highly leveraged, sometimes within a substantial equity positions. So they value being the first in an industry, thinking that their first move advantage. This firm will be structured with each strategic business unit having considerable autonomy. Then next one is defender strategy. So defender strategy is nothing, as they tend to do none of things happens to prospectors. Actually, the defender strategy entails finding, maintaining a secure, relatively stable, rather than being a cutting edge. So this technology innovation products, it will engage in a vertical integration. So offer a tend to slower in a making decisions with only a commit to change in a after. And the next one is analyzer. So analyzer means it is between the defender and prospector. Okay, they take less risk and make less mistakes than a prospector, but are less committed in stability than defender. Most firms are analyzer. They are seldom in a first mover in an industry. Okay, so but often second of the third place entrance. So they tend to expand into areas close to their existing core competency. So rather than develop wholly a new products, they make incremental improvements in existing the products. And the next one is reactor. So which has no proactive strategy. So often reacting to events to the occur, they respond only when they are forced by macro environmental pressures. So this is the least effective of the four strategies. So it is without a direction or a focus, have identified three reasons why organization become reactors. Okay, so top management may not have clearly articulate or organization's strategy. Next, aggressive investment strategy. So this is typically refers to a style of portfolio management. So this strategy for achieving higher than average returns, typically the capital appreciation as a primary investment objectives. So rather than income or a safety of principal, such a strategy would therefore have an asset allocation with a substantial weighting in stocks and possibly little or no allocation to bonds or cash. So this aggressive investment strategies are typically thought to be suitable for young adults with smaller portfolio sizes, because the lengthy investment horizon enables them to ride out market fluctuations and losses early in one's career, have less impact than later. So the investment advisors do not consider the strategy suitable for anyone else but younger adults unless such strategy. So this, regardless of investors' strategy, aggressive investment strategy, under this, aggressive investing accepts more risk in pursuit of greater return. The second one, aggressive portfolio management may achieve its aim through one or more many of strategies including asset selection, asset allocation. Third one, investor trends after 2012 showed a preference away from aggressive strategies and active management and towards passive indexed investing. Okay, so by this class is over. We'll continue in next class. Okay, take care.